Hi, you're watching New York State Legislative Report with Senator Martin Malave Dilan. I'm Julia Locandy. The Senator and I today are going to talk about redistricting. It's great to be with you, Senator.
Thank you for having me.
You know, you are continuing your work to reform the state's redistricting process and have been appointed the member of the Legislative Task Force on Demographic Research and Reappointment for the Senate Democratic Conference.
Yes, well, I look forward to working with my colleagues in the legislature to see that we come up with a fair plan.
Okay, so I just want to give people a background of, you know, what's been going on in your work with redistricting. You know, leading up to the recent appointment, the task force under your leadership had been conducting roundtables with key redistricting stakeholders, including representatives from voting and civil rights organizations, faith-based groups, bar associations, academia, and good government and reform organizations. In addition, public meetings were conducted in Albany and New York City to gauge public opinion on a number of issues surrounding redistricting, including what goals and criteria should be considered, and the formation of an independent redistricting commission to conduct the process. Today, Senator, you are pushing for a fair and balanced redistricting process. Tell us what's exactly going on in that process right now.
Well, as you know, there's been movement by external forces, especially an uprising in New York with former Mayor Koch, who has been pushing for independent redistricting. Many of my colleagues in the legislature on both sides of the aisle signed his pledge. Last year, I did not sign the pledge because I have a policy, one, of not signing anyone's pledge, although I feel that we do need to reform the way that we do draw the districts. One of the things that I would love to see happen in terms of reform is that we lower the deviation and that every single district throughout the state of New York has equal population for one person, one vote.
Okay, so as we just saw on a graphic there, it told us what the U.S. Constitution, every 10 years the lines are drawn and it reflects the population shifts. Tell us what the task force and demographic research and reapportionment, how it analyzes the Bureau population figures.
Okay, first of all, it's composed of two co-chairpersons, one person from the majority in the Assembly and one from the majority in the Senate, and then two members, minority Assembly and minority in the Senate, with two private citizens. And this group technically makes up the board, and the Lackford also has technical staff, an executive director, and they take all the information that comes in from the U.S. Census Department, Bureau rather, and we expect that the final numbers would be in by April 1st of this year. Technical staff would take all that information, put it into databases, and they would begin the process of sort of dealing with the population shifts and attempting to make the districts equal so all districts could be balanced. And there's the communities of interest that you try to keep together. One of the goals that I know I had as a as the co-chair was to have entire transparency in the process so the citizens of New York can feel that we are in the process of formulating districts that are representative of the respective communities. And in New York City, you have at least three counties that fall within the Voting Rights Act, and they are monitored by the Department of Justice. For example, last year, the now Attorney General and State Senator Eric Schneiderman presented legislation that would count prisoners in their home districts, not in the prisons. And that has to go to the Justice Department for pre-clearance. And I believe that submission occurred yesterday, and now the Justice Department has 60 days to respond.
All right. So, you know, in the meantime, we've been hearing, this has been all over the media, we've been hearing a lot of phrases being thrown around, from gerrymandering to, as you talked about, prison-based gerrymandering, Voting Rights Act of 1965, and the ever-popular independent redistricting panel. So let's explain to our viewers what exactly we're talking about here, and if any progress has been made starting with independent redistricting.
waiting for me.
So a constitutional amendment to create a new independent commission to redistrict the state Senate, Assembly, and Congressional by removing such authority from the legislature and governor and vesting it in a new commission consisting of 8 commissioners. Now, that's a bill that's yours, and that was from 2010, correct?
That's correct. And, you know, that's a bill, actually, that is made up of 2 separate bills, and actually the governor, Andrew Cuomo, actually put it into his program bill. So the current bill that is being considered is mostly those 2 bills that I introduced last year and I reintroduced this year. And I believe that he took pieces from the Janaris bill and perhaps Bileski also and submitted that to the legislature. And that is the bill that is currently out in the public, and in terms of the reform groups, that's the bill that they are supporting. To be quite honest, I think this process should have started in 2006, 2007, because there are constitutional issues that have to be considered. However, if there is a willingness to really do independent redistricting, it can be done, and it can be done on a timely basis where you have private citizens taking all the information that I mentioned previously with respect to the Latford, and they can then make recommendations to the governor and to the legislature as to what the ultimate or the final look of the district should be.
Right. Okay, so you basically briefly talked about it, but let's take a look at these 2 bills that you're sponsoring right now. They both bolster public participation in the redistricting process through bipartisan appointed advisory commissions, and both create an objective and transparent redistricting process that maximizes public participation.
Right. You know, these bills, as I indicated, the governor did put those into his program bill. And it's just the process of just ensuring that the citizens of New York can feel confident that it's not the legislature picking the voters instead of the voters picking the representative. And I believe that moving forward, the most important part of this is that we have to lower that deviation between district, which currently now is 10%, to a lower number. I think anywhere below 5%, maybe 4%, 3% would be fair. In the districts where you have the Voting Rights Act, I think a low deviation may be impossible because the Justice Department has to weigh in. But at the end of the day, it's just keeping communities of interest together, keeping local towns together, local communities that are homogeneous together, so people can feel that they have an involvement in government.
So it seems that in some form or another, there's a strong support for such a commission. And if not, you know, at least a call to reform the process.
Yes, there is. As you know, all the community, Women League of Voters and Citizens Unions and various groups throughout the state of New York have indicated for many decades now that we should not be selecting our voters, and it should be the other way around. I think that as long as we can involve the citizens of New York in the process and make the process totally transparent, we're talking about setting up a web page where individuals could possibly even go in there and draw districts that they could present as proposals for us. As a member of Latford, I don't know how the 2 co-chairs are going to proceed, but if they do not hold public hearings as an individual member, I do intend to go around the state and put out whatever proposals are out there. I do intend to hold some type of public meetings or hearings where different communities of interest throughout the state, like Buffalo, Rochester, Syracuse, Long Island, New York City, even in Binghamton, can have input into the process and where they can feel that they were a part of that process.
Right, and I also think that it's important for New Yorkers to understand what this exactly is, because there's a lot of stuff swirling around about what it is and what it can be.
You know, it's very difficult sometimes for people to understand really what it is. And there is discussion right now that, you know, the budget is the priority. But this is something that happens every 10 years. And as populations shift, the deviation of that population become greater in some districts and less in others. And it goes back to that concept of one person, one vote, where we have to balance all the districts, so every single Senate district, every congressional district, and every state assembly district can have equal number of citizens, so everyone has an equal one vote in terms of weighted vote. And it's a very difficult process for people to understand, but for those that are interested in who their representatives are, this is an important process. Also, for many minority communities, it could be of importance where, for example, in Queens, you have a very large Bangladesh community that testified in the hearings, and they feel that they should have a representative in one of the houses of the legislature. In Buffalo, there's a growing Latino community that's interested in attempting to get someone elected from their community. And all this is done to at least give different communities an opportunity to elect someone who they feel comfortable with, or someone who lives within the community and they feel can best represent them.
Right. And when it comes to redistricting, many of our viewers may have heard about the Voting Rights Act of 1965. Right. So tell us what exactly it is and what kind of role it plays within redistricting.
Well, again, this is, for example, I represent one of those Voting Rights Act district, and basically I believe what the 1965 Act requires is that you give, let's say, for example, a community that may be a majority, let's say the Latino community, at least the opportunity or the ability to have someone from their own ethnic background perhaps represent them. And that doesn't necessarily mean that you make the district 70%, you could make it 50%, 55%, and at least give them the opportunity and make the district competitive for someone from their community to get elected.
Okay, let's now talk about the goals and criteria that you would like to see implemented as the redistricting process moves forward this year or the next. And that is making redistricting data available to the public, minimizing population deviation at the end of the regional bias in redistricting, and preserve the jurisdictional integrity of counties and most towns as required by the state constitution, as well as maintaining better district and compactness and to protect communities of interest.
Okay, these criteria came as a result of the hearings that we did hold last year and as a result of the roundtables with the various stakeholders throughout the city and academia. And really it's just to make the process more interactive with the voters and the citizens of the state of New York. And I believe that if we follow this criteria, I know I do intend to have this to be my guide as I move forward, and hopefully I can work with the co-chair in the Senate and in the Assembly to ensure that at least this process is followed. And I think that it's also in line with the governor's program bill, and I think it's in line with the criteria that the public interest groups and those advocates that have been out there for a long time, this is all they're looking for. They're just looking for fairness in the process, and we really hope that this independent commission does draw the lines and that the process follows a normal line instead of allowing a judge panel or the Justice Department or some outside force drawing the lines for New York State. I think that it should be a process that we follow, and I think that any reform that we have should also involve the community at large, and it should not be, even the advocate groups, you know, they may have their own interests, so I think it should be a decision by the whole.
Thank you so much for being with us, Senator.
Thank you very much.
If you would like to know more about Senator Dilan's efforts to reform the redistricting process, you can go onto his website, dilan.nysenate.gov, or his Facebook page.